Hello, this is David Diga Hernandez, and you are watching Spirit Church here on the Encounter TV network. Impartation is the transfer that takes place in the Spirit from a mentor to a disciple through relationship. Impartation has the power to accelerate your spiritual growth. This is why I want to give you right now five simple biblical keys to receiving impartation. But first, Stephen Moctezuma is here with me. He's going to lead you in some very anointed worship, and then I'm going to get right into this teaching. Here is Stephen Moctezuma.
In my life, Lord, be glorified, be glorified.
Now, before I give you the five keys to receiving impartation, I want to define impartation. Impartation is the transfer in the Spirit that takes place in relationship between a mentor and a disciple. Examples of impartation are Elijah and Elisha, Moses and Joshua, Jesus and his disciples, to some degree, Saul and David, Paul and Timothy. When I connect with a spiritual mentor, I begin to see acceleration in my spiritual growth. I see acceleration in my understanding of the Word. I see acceleration in ministry. I see acceleration in many different aspects of my spiritual life. So it's important that we connect with people who can help pull us along, people who've gone further down the path that can help us and guide us as we walk closer to our destinies in Christ. As I continue, I want you to understand the difference between the anointing and the mantle. The anointing is the power. The mantle is the authority in which that power operates. The anointing is the ability. The mantle is the boundary of that ability. For example, I know hundreds of evangelists, but there is only one Billy Graham. Every evangelist who is anointed by God has the power for evangelism. But not every evangelist who evangelizes has the mantle that Billy Graham carried. I mean, think about this for a second. Evangelists often say, and I think we have to be more careful with the way we word our ministry experience. Evangelists often say, oh, I'm a national evangelist, or oh, I'm an international evangelist, or oh, I'm a world-renowned evangelist. And I think we have to be careful with exaggerating where we are in the Spirit, because when we exaggerate where we are in the Spirit, it causes us to lose the ability to receive from others who are actually further along than us. So don't exaggerate your influence. And the reason I'm saying that is to make this point. When I say that an evangelist has a national mantle, I mean that when they speak, nations turn. I think of Billy Graham. Billy Graham had a mantle for the nations. Think about how ministry begins to be given to us as we are faithful to what God has already given to us. For example, when I'm first anointed, the anointing touches my life personally. Then that anointing expands Corporately, I begin to minister to those around me, those in the local body of Christ near me. Then it moves regionally, and I begin to impact the region around that church. Then, of course, it goes national, then it goes global, then it goes generational, then it goes eternal. Impact has many different levels. But as I begin to grow in the anointing, which is the power of God, God also expands the mantle. So again, using Billy Graham as an example, Billy Graham carried a mantle for the nations. Billy Graham really carried and was one of the few in modern day to carry a global mantle to where he was able to speak. He was anointed as an evangelist. That was his anointing. But his mantle, his assignment, was for the world. Now, compare that. And in this case, it's okay to compare. If we compare to compete, that's when it's wrong. But if we compare to get a proper view of ourselves or to get a greater understanding of our place in the working of the body of Christ, then comparison is okay. But when we compare different mantles to other mantles, we begin to see that there are distinct assignments that people are given. So the anointing can be imparted. That's the power, the ability, a spiritual gift, maybe praying for the sick, prophesying, and so forth. But then a mantle can also be imparted. A mantle is something that is given to an individual for an assignment. So there is a mantle to take the healing ministry to the world. There is a mantle to introduce the Holy Spirit to a generation. There is a mantle to evangelize and influence political realms. There is a mantle for different operations of the anointing. There is a mantle for different operations of different kinds of gifting and power. All of it, of course, is sourced by the Holy Spirit. So again, before I proceed, I want to make sure you understand the difference between the mantle and the anointing. The mantle is the level of authority in which the anointing operates. And the anointing, of course, is the power. So when I get around people who are anointed in certain areas, the anointing on their life begins to rub off on mine. When I get around people who carry certain mantles, then it's possible that I can catch that mantle. It's possible that what God assigned to them can be in some ways assigned to me. I must stress here, of course, that impartation is not imitation. You're not the next anyone, you're the first you. And when you're anointed of God, you're uniquely anointed of God. So I'm not saying that you become a next somebody or that you take the place of an individual who has gone home to be with the Lord. No, I'm simply saying that assignments can be generational, not speaking strictly in blood, but assignments can be generational even by the Spirit. God does not assign mantles based upon who you're related to, who you married, how long you've been a part of something. God assigns mantles based upon His wisdom and based upon His preference and based upon what He sees fit. So that transfer can take place between individuals whether or not they're related by blood. So to recap here, impartation is spiritual transfer that takes place from between a spiritual mentor and a spiritual disciple. That impartation can accelerate growth in many areas, but as I'm speaking about it specifically here, I'm referencing impartation as it has to do with the anointing, which is the power of God, and the mantle, which is the authority or the level in which that power can operate. So how do you receive that from individuals? How do you get some of what's on somebody's life to rub off on yours? And this is a biblical principle. Again, I reference some examples, the prophets, Moses and Joshua, Jesus and the disciples, Saul and David to some degree, which is an interesting point that I want to make. And then again, of course, Paul and Timothy. So how do I receive this? How do I actually live my life in a way where I can align myself with the will of God, where I can align myself to where I become somebody that's positioned to catch a mantle that's falling to the earth? Well, number one is time with the Lord. 1 John 2:27 says, "But you have received the Holy Spirit, and He lives within you. So you don't need anyone to teach you what is true. For the Spirit teaches you everything you need to know, and what He teaches is true. It is not a lie. So just as He has taught you, remain in fellowship with Christ." So the Holy Spirit teaches us within us. Acts chapter 4, verse 13 also holds a powerful key. And that portion of scripture says this: "The members of the council were amazed when they saw the boldness of Peter and John, for they could see that they were ordinary men with no special training in the scriptures. They also recognized them as men who had been with Jesus." So here we see, number one, that 1 John 2:27 tells us that there's an anointing within us that the Holy Spirit teaches us. And also, according to Acts chapter 4, verse 13, that the men who were used by God had no special training in Scripture whatsoever, but their qualification was that they had been with Jesus. So, time with the Lord is the most important aspect of impartation. But just because it is mentioned first, that doesn't mean that it ceases to become something that we have to tend to as life moves on. No, foundations are where the structure is built. When I spend time with Jesus, when I spend time in the presence of the Holy Spirit, when I spend time with the Lord, I am building a foundation upon which I can build my spiritual life, upon which I can build a ministry. If there are holes in that foundation, if there are holes at the beginning of the construction of your spiritual life, then when you begin to build upon it and you begin to add weight and pressure, then what is built upon it begins to cause the foundation to collapse. And because the foundation was not built properly, what I begin to add to it causes it to crumble, and what was supposed to bless me ends up destroying me because I did not tend to that which was most important, namely this foundation, this time with the Lord. You cannot buy the anointing. You cannot just go say, hey, lay hands on me, I want what you have. No, there's a price to pay, and that price to pay is time with the Lord. So even if I could, by forcing my way in, cause a man or a woman to lay hands on me and impart to me a mantle, that mantle they impart to me would not bless me, and I would not end up using it to do good in the kingdom of God. Instead, that mantle placed on me would crush me because I lack a foundation. I must spend time with the Lord. Time with the Lord, number one, is the key to receiving impartation. I can't buy it. I must pay the price for it. Remember, Simon the sorcerer in Acts chapter 8 tried to buy the power of the Holy Spirit from the apostles, and they rebuked him for it. They said, may your money perish with you, and perhaps God will forgive you. That's what it says in Acts 8:22. Simon the sorcerer was rebuked not only because he had impure motives in wanting the power, but because he wanted the power without the process. He wanted to just skip through it. He treated it like it was cheap. Oh, let me just buy it. You can't buy it. You can't pay a registration fee, go to a conference, and walk out with the anointing. You can't buy an online e-course, study the material, listen to the videos, and then be anointed as a prophet. No, that's not how this works. Time with the Lord is how you receive the impartation. So that's foundational. That's the first. That's where I build what God has given to me. So, number one, time with the Lord. Number two is teaching. Now, in Matthew chapter number 28, beginning at verse 19, Jesus said this, therefore go and make disciples of all nations. And then he tells us how to make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Teach these new disciples to obey all the commands I have given you, and be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. So here we see that disciples are made through teaching. Number two, one of the keys to impartation, is through teaching. I receive impartation by receiving the teaching of great men and women of God. As long as they're teaching sound doctrine, as long as they're teaching inspired by the Holy Spirit, then what I receive from them begins to bless my life, and it causes me to grow spiritually. This is why it's so important that we first lay that foundation of time with the Lord. That time with the Lord actually gives me the discernment that I need, which will help me distinguish between what is godly teaching and what is heresy. So if I lack this foundation, if I lack this time with the Lord, if I am not building in the secret place, then I am easily pulled away to doctrines of demons. I am easily pulled away out of the path of orthodox scriptural teaching. So if I don't have time with the Lord, then I'll receive teaching from just anyone. But if I lay a solid foundation and I connect with the Holy Spirit, then when I hear teaching, my spirit will leap and I'll say, that's of God. That's a man of God. That's a woman of God. This is not to say, of course, that we won't have disagreements. Of course, we'll all have disagreements on varying topics. But this at least helps to build a foundation in such a way that I won't be pulled completely off track We can disagree on minor issues, but when it comes to the fundamentals of the faith, we must be grounded. But number two, teaching is still a very beneficial key to receiving impartation. Remember this, though, and I'm going to give you some advice here that I've learned personally. Mentors want a return on their investment. If you're going to receive impartation from a spiritual mentor, then I encourage you to be worth their time. Use what they give you. Learn from their talk before you learn from their walk. What do I mean by that? I mean, you have to know their teachings before you can come into relationship with them and them spend time on you. I'll give you an example. People often message me. I kid you not, at least once a day I receive a message from someone saying, I want you to be my mentor. I want to connect with you. And they want me to email back, and they'll send me lists of questions that they have, say, mentor me. And what's interesting to me is I'll look at the list of questions. They'll ask me things like, how do I hear the voice of God? And I'll think, I have a teaching on that on YouTube. They'll say, how do I pray? I say, well, I have like a dozen teachings on that on YouTube. They'll say, who is the Holy Spirit? I say, well, I have a lot of teachings about who the Holy Spirit is. They say, teach me this, teach me that, never realizing that I have it all available online for free. And it makes me think, wow, they say they want me to mentor them. They say they want me to take the time to spend on them, yet they haven't taken the time to go and learn all what I have available before they come and ask me for what's not available. That to me shows they're not really serious about mentorship. They just want a quick fix and they want to jump ahead. But when I seek out a mentor, as we all should, what I do is I first become familiar with the teachings that they've put out. Once I know those teachings, then God can trust me with the relationship. I'll touch on that in just a little bit. So number two is teaching. Yes, I know 1 John 2:27 says that no man needs to teach you, but we have to remember that 1 John 2:27 was talking about that inner knowing, that inner knowing that keeps you from falling away from the faith. It was not talking about doctrines of Scripture and ministry and training. Otherwise, God in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11 would not have assigned to us teachers. And in fact, the Scripture often encourages people to use their teaching gift. So no, God is not against a man teaching a man. God is not against an individual teaching an individual. But 1 John 2:27 is simply speaking about the fact that we should be grounded in Him before we go learning from other mentors. So teaching is biblical. Yes, we can learn from other people, and it is the second key to receiving impartation. Now, I know my lesson is going a little longer than usual, but I really wanted you to get all this. I thought about doing this in a two-part lesson, but I just knew that we had to go through this whole thing all at once. I wanted to give it to you all. It's something that you can, you know, receive again and again and again. And I want you to really listen to this over and over and receive all of these little, I'll call them nuggets of truth, that you might apply them to your life. So again, I know this is going to go longer than usual, but I encourage you to stay with me because this is really a journey that I'm walking you through. You'll notice number one is time with the Lord. That's where I'm building my foundation. Then number two, after I've been solidified in the Lord, now I can safely move into the realm of receiving teaching. And these two can take place at the same time. Don't lock yourself away and say, I'm not listening to anybody till I figure this out for myself. That would just be dangerous. Isolation is a very dangerous place to be spiritually. So we receive from the Lord that foundation while also receiving from others that God has assigned to us. This is biblical. And then number three, now we find something interesting. In 1 Timothy chapter number 4, verse 14, the Bible says this, do not neglect the spiritual gift you receive through the prophecy spoken over you when the elders of the church laid their hands on you. And then in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 6 and 7, the Scripture says, this is why I remind you to fan into flames the spiritual gift God gave you when I laid my hands on you. For God has not given us a spirit of fear and timidity, but of power and love and self-discipline. So here the Scripture is saying that impartation, a spiritual gift, was given to the laying on of hands, which is really the next phase. So here's how it works. You spend time with the Lord, you build that foundation. Then you move into receiving from others. You receive from their teachings. God begins to build your faith. God begins to accelerate your spiritual growth through what other great men and women of God are saying. And then Many of you have actually done this. After I begin to receive from their teaching, I become familiar with their ministry. Then I'll go to a service and they'll lay hands on me, or they'll pray for me through YouTube or through television. And again, your mentor, spiritually speaking, does not need to be someone who's well-known or in media. You have spiritual mentors in your life who you might be overlooking just because you don't think they're popular. I think it's interesting that people will post sermons and videos from famous preachers while never once posting anything that their pastor says Sunday to Sunday. And that shows me that familiarity has blocked the flow of the anointing, which I'll touch on in a little bit here also. But you can find a spiritual mentor, really anyone who's living a godly life and loves the Lord, knows the Word better than you, and has gone further along in their spiritual journey. That person is a candidate to be a spiritual mentor. And so we must not neglect the familiar because we're always looking to the spectacular or what we perceive to be spectacular. Your mentor doesn't have to be famous or have to have this wide reach. You just got to find someone who's walking with the Lord and is further along that path than you are. But the laying on of hands is a very spiritual act. Now, if I lay my hands on someone who's received none of the teachings, they're going to feel the power of God. They may even fall out under the power of the Holy Spirit, but they're going to get right back up again and they're going to walk out. And unless they apply the teachings paired with the laying on of hands, they're not really going to activate what was given to them when I laid hands on them. So there is a deposit that is made when you lay hands and an activation that occurs when you begin to live by the teachings. So laying on of hands, yes, can deposit something. But the more powerful form of impartation comes when I live what has been taught. So, number one, time with the Lord, I build that foundation. Then I begin to build on that foundation with the teaching of the Word. I can have other things deposited into me, spiritual gifts, mantles, the anointing, through the laying on of hands. And that activates something greater. It deposits the Word. And that, coupled together with what I've been receiving, begins to cause me to experience accelerated growth. Number four is honor and service. Now, this is going to be a very challenging one. So, number one, time with the Lord. Number two, teaching. Number three, the laying on of hands. Number four is honor and service. Now, I'm really going to shock a lot of you with some of the things I'm going to say right now, but I want you to ask the Holy Spirit to help you receive this as I'm teaching this, because for many of you, it's going to be very different than some of the things you might have been taught, but I've seen it in Scripture. So, 1 Samuel chapter 16, beginning at verse 14. Now the Spirit of the Lord had left Saul, and the Lord sent a tormenting spirit that filled him with depression and fear. Some of Saul's servants said to him, "A tormenting spirit from God is troubling you. Let us find a good musician to play the harp whenever the tormenting spirit troubles you. He will play soothing music, and you will soon be well again." Here we see that Saul, who was once anointed by God, Saul, who once had been appointed as king, was now stripped of his position in the spirit, at least. He was still king. There was still some time for that transition to take place. But now he's being tormented by an evil spirit. Here's what I believe. I don't believe that God sent that tormenting spirit to Saul just to torment him. Yes, of course, it was there to torment his mind, but why? Why? Why did God do this? God did this as a last resort, trying to get Saul to repent. Let me prove it to you. In Psalm chapter 51, we see that David himself was also tormented. Look what he says in Psalm 51, verse 8. "Oh, give me back my joy again." He's repenting from sin. Listen to what he says. "You have broken me. Now let me rejoice. Don't keep looking at my sins. Remove the stain of my guilt." When these men were in sin, the Lord would break them. And I believe he was using a tormenting spirit to try to break Saul. He was trying to get Saul to repent. It was the Lord's mercy that sent that spirit. God, as a last resort, had sent that spirit to try to get him to transform. Saul could have been a godly mentor to David. There could have been a godly transition from Saul to David. But instead of having the kingdom transferred from him, Saul had the kingdom torn from him. And this represents a generational gap that I pray is soon closed, even in generations on the earth today. where those who are in the faith and those who have been established are having to have things torn from them because they're not right with God, instead of getting right with God and participating in God's plan to transfer that assignment to a new generation. So, David, however, served Saul. Let's go back to 1 Samuel chapter number 16. I'm going to go back there, 1 Samuel chapter number 16. Now I'm going to read down at verse 21. This is what the Bible says. So David went to Saul and began serving him. Saul loved David very much, and David became his armor bearer. Now this really got me thinking. I'm thinking, here we have a man who's not right with God. He's got a tormenting spirit on him, yet David serves him. This should do away with our excuses when it comes to being offended by men and women of God. Some of you have left the church, and because you've been hurt, some of you have gone away from the people of God because you've been hurt. But I'm telling you, Saul tried to kill David, and David still honored him. In fact, in 1 Samuel chapter 26, verses 7 through 9, David has an opportunity to retaliate against Saul, who was trying to kill him. Saul was vulnerable. David could have killed him. But David, instead of taking that opportunity to kill Saul, says, I'm not going to touch God's anointed. Even though Saul was a flawed man, David didn't see the flawed man. He saw the anointing. And this is where we must adjust our perspective if ever we are to receive impartation. We must honor and serve. Now, if a leader is living in at a blatant level of sin, or they're abusing you in some way, then you need to get away from that leader. That's more of a cult leader than a spiritual leader. But if we're rejecting spiritual leaders simply because they have flaws, which we all do, then we'll never have a spiritual leader in our lives. Here's what God does, and here's how the process works. At first, you see the leader from a distance. You watch their teachings. Maybe you watch them from Sunday to Sunday on the pulpit. Maybe you watch their broadcast, whatever. You see the leader, and from a distance, man, it's glamorous. Wow, look at that man. Look at that woman. They're so anointed. They're so powerful. What a great word. And from a distance, it looks like perfection. But then God moves us in closer. And when we become closer, we begin to see flaws. And when we see flaws, most people go, that's it. You have flaws. I knew it. Everybody's fake. I can't trust no one. I'm out. That's spiritual immaturity, and it's going to keep you from receiving the anointing. That's what I'm talking about, familiarity blocking the anointing. When you become familiar with the man or woman of God, it blocks your ability to receive impartation from them. So from a distance, they look wonderful. Then I move closer, and I see the flaws, and I say, well, I can't receive from them because they do this, this, and this. Look, you need to have grace for them. If you don't have grace for them, God won't give you the grace to receive from them. I want to say that again. If you don't have grace for them, God won't give you the grace to receive from them. So distance, it looks like perfection. I move in closer. I begin to see the flaws. I feel disillusioned. But then something powerful happens. Once I'm willing to give them grace for their flaws, God moves me in even closer. And when I move in even closer, I go from saying, wow, you look perfect, to wow, you look flawed, to saying, wow, that's why God uses you. And revelation begins to open. And the intimacy they have with the Holy Spirit begins to become apparent to you. And God begins to reveal to you why He's using them. And then what is on their life begins to rub off on yours. I truly believe that God hides the anointing within abrasive humanity so that only the persistent might be worthy of the anointing within them. Now, I can't necessarily claim to prove that scripturally. It's my experience. I see some scriptural principles that point to that conclusion, but I'm convinced that God hides the anointing within abrasive humanity so that only the persistent can receive it. And we must serve to God's satisfaction. We must look beyond that, recognizing we're not serving the man, we're serving the man of God. But in serving the man of God, in serving and honoring the man and woman of God, I must also come into relationship with the man. There's the man of God, there's the man. There's the woman of God, there's the woman. If I want to receive from the of God, I must serve the humanity. And in that, I find humility. In that, I find my ego being shrunk. In that, I find discipline. In that, I find patience. And in that, there is impartation. In Mark chapter 6, verse 5, Jesus could only do a few miracles because he wasn't honored in his hometown. Dishonor blocks the anointing, and familiarity is the breeding ground for dishonor. Number 5, proximity. Now this is where, again, here's the journey. Time with the Lord, my foundation is laid. Then I move into receiving from their teachings. Then maybe I might have the chance to have hands laid on me. That's where most people end it, because most people can't handle the flaws of the man and woman of God. But then I go into honor and serve, and in honor and serving, I move in closer, and that opens up the door for me to see their flaws. But once I have grace for them, God gives me the grace to receive from them. I move in, and now I'm right where I need to be. This is where the most powerful form of impartation takes place. That is number 5, proximity or relationship. Romans chapter 1, verse 11 says this, "For I long to visit you, so I can bring you some spiritual gift that will help you grow strong in the Lord." Why did Paul long to visit them in order to do this? Why not just write a letter and do it? Why not just send a messenger and do it? He had to come in person because there are certain things that could only be transferred through proximity and relationship. Here's the truth. Some would say, "David, I want you as a mentor." I'll tell you this, some of you would not like me as a person. I'm not saying I'm a horrible person, but some of you just would have issues with my personality quirks and my character flaws, which I do have. Some of you would be offended at some of the ways I think in some things. It's just a reality. Many of the people who you see me connecting with, you probably said to yourself, "I wish I could," but you see, you have to have grace for them before you can have grace to receive from them. So my question to you, who's the man or the woman of God in your life? I'm not talking about abuses. If they're abusing you, disconnect. That's a cult leader, not a man or woman of God. But if you're just offended because of flaws in them, offended because they're not everything you'd hope they would be, or offended because they have shortcomings, then you really need to push past that. Because God wants to raise you. And if God is going to raise you, he wants to accelerate you. And if he's going to accelerate you, there must be impartation. So, to recap the journey, it begins in my private time with the Lord. Once that foundation is laid, I build upon that with the teachings. I have hands laid on me to deposit other things and to activate through the mixing of the laying on of hands and the teaching. Then I find a place to serve and honor. And in my service and honor, I may be exposed to things that offend me. But if I can move past that offense, then behind that abrasiveness, there is the treasure of the anointing, and that proximity and relationship really opens up the power of God. I've lived this. I know this to be true. I've done it again and again and again with people who I receive from. And that proximity, once you connect with it, it accelerates you. There's growth beyond what you could ever imagine possible. Well, that is it for the lesson. I know it's a little bit longer than usual, but again, I wanted to get all of these principles out to you. I want to pray with you now. I want to pray that God would open your eyes to see where you might receive impartation. Father, in the name of Jesus, I lift that one to you now, asking to be accelerated in the Spirit through the gift of impartation. And I ask you, Lord, in the name of Jesus, to anoint them, to open their eyes, cause them to see. Help them to not become familiar with that which you've gifted them with. In the name of Jesus, we pray. I want you to say it because you believe it. Say amen. I want to welcome now the new members of Spirit Church. There you are up on the screen. We love you and we are praying for you. I always say that because I always mean it. If you like information on how you can join the Spirit family, go to davidhernandezministries.com/spiritchurch. It's 100% free. You'll get an email from me every single week with a brand new teaching worship song from Stephen Moctezuma. And the best part, you can reply to that email for prayer support from our ministry staff. Now I'm going to read your comments. These comments come from last week's teaching, How to Be a Friend of the Holy Spirit, 4 keys. In that teaching, I gave you 4 simple keys that you can apply immediately to draw closer to the Holy Spirit than ever before. Make sure you go check that out. And while you do that, if you're watching us on YouTube, be sure to subscribe. Click that notification bell so that you don't miss a thing. By the way, we're so close to 200,000 subscribers. Do me a favor, share the content with 3 of your loved ones. I believe we can reach 200,000 subscribers before the end of the year. Now to your comments again. These are from last week. Oh, by the way, if you want me to potentially read your comments next week, then go ahead and comment now in the comment section, and I may read them on the next edition of Spirit Church here on the Encounter TV Network. These comments come from How to Be a Friend of the Holy Spirit, Four Keys. Joyce Pitcher writes, "This is so powerful. Thanks so much, Pastor David. God bless you and your family. May the Holy Spirit continue to work in you and through you." Sarah Nianzi writes, "Thank you, David. I needed this. The Holy Spirit has helped me through a challenging week. I am His. I belong to Him." Marcia wrote, "Thank you, David. I thank the Holy Spirit. Today I was speaking to God and telling Him that it is time that I become His friend. And well, I found this video tonight. Thank you for helping me to understand how to become His friend. God bless you." And then Kenya writes, "I have watched some of your videos. Last week, my circumstances, especially at school, turned upside down. I felt so alone. But I started to realize that the Holy Spirit is my best friend. Exactly on that day, you posted a video, Holy Spirit, Faithful Friend. I was reminded and learned more about the Holy Spirit. I was crying last night and told myself that I want to be a good friend to the Holy Spirit, and today I saw this video. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Pastor David. God bless you, your family, and your ministry." Well, the reason these divine appointments happen so often here on our channel is because this is the Holy Spirit's channel. He can do whatever He wants with it. And this is why I need your help. Don't turn the video off. I need your help with something. If you've been blessed by this ministry, I want you to be aware of the fact that really we're reaching many people all around the world. You are helping us change the world, literally. By spreading the word of God all over the world, we're transforming the world. Lives are being changed. Souls are being saved. That's so important. That is the most important thing. There's no cause you can find that makes a bigger difference. This cause, the cause of the gospel, doesn't just change lives, it changes eternities. And so I want you to help us out with this. If you've been blessed by this ministry, I want you to realize this content we release for free. We don't charge for the Word of God. I don't believe in charging for the Word of God. We don't charge for our events. There's no registration fee. Anybody can come. Freely we have received, so freely we give. So we do it the biblical way, which is we take offerings and we leave it with the people of God. God funds His ministry through His people, and God wants to use you to keep this ministry going. Here's what I need you to do. Become a monthly supporter. Look, if you've been praying about this, considering this, I'm asking you to do this today. There are things that are coming. The ministry is growing. We are seeing, I know I say this all the time, but it really is the truth. Every single month, it grows more and more and more and more. And we're really approaching, I believe, another growth spurt, which is going to launch this ministry into places it's never been before. And you'll be able to say, I was there from the beginning. So help me reach the world. I can't do it without you. It's you and I together with the power of the Holy Spirit that will reach the world. So become my partner today. Go to davidhernandezministries.com/donate and sign up to become a $30 a month supporter. When you do, I will send you either Carriers of the Glory, Encountering the Holy Spirit in every book of the Bible, or 25 Truths About Demons and Spiritual Warfare. I'll sign it. I'll send it to you. It'll be my initiation gift to you to say thank you for supporting this ministry. Of course, you can also give a one-time gift into the ministry. Everything helps. We now accept stock donations, cryptocurrency, Apple Pay, PayPal. You can give through any means to help support the gospel, and you can give from anywhere in the world. Go to davidhernandezministries.com/donate. Do that right now, and I know the Lord will bless you for it as we continue to make impact all around the world. Well, that is it for this edition of Spirit Church here on the Encounter TV Network. Until next time, remember, nothing is impossible with God. Thank you for watching Encounter TV. Don't forget to subscribe and click the notification bell. Also, help us spread the gospel of Jesus Christ in the power of the Holy Spirit. Make a one-time donation or become a monthly supporter by clicking on the donate link now.